Dire Team Ban. Radiant Team Ban. Dire Team Ban. Remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Radiant team pick.
Mirana. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Betway WCA 2016 European Edition Game 2 of Kaipe versus Vegas Squadron. Oh, that Game 1 Meepo, devastating. We're going to be here in Game 2. Could end up being a quick series if we have a repeat of what we just saw. I'm Zayori, joined again by Annie. We're from Moonduck TV. Thanks a lot for joining us here, folks. Another first pick, Mirana. Annie, feeling here coming into Game 2?
Feeling pretty good. Definitely energized by a good Meepo Huskar game. Oh, I feel bad saying that, but
33,
it
baby.
Was awesome. And now Kunkka, first pick per Kaipe. They're just going. They are having a blast. Vega up to go. They take Sing Sing's Mirana away. They weren't able to ban it out in the first round, so just pick it up for themselves. Mirana was just a superstar in TI. She's been a superstar since. She got her Starstorm damage nerfed a little bit, I think, but she's still super impactful when she gets Aghanim Scepter.
Absolutely, and that is the turning point for her. Usually, it's more about fishing arrows, maybe getting some decent ultimates off to try to find some ganks, but the damage comes when the Aghanims comes out, for sure. Now, Kunkka Shadow Demon for Kaipe here. Potential to be the support duo, though, could also be a core Kunkka with just a support Shadow Demon. Either way, a lot of good setup, a lot of synergy between these two heroes with Disruption right into Torrent.
Please, Terrorblade.
Just for X and all that good stuff, yeah. And now, they have to think about Illusion Heroes. I mean, if you're Vegas Squadron, you can't ban out all three, the big three, Luna, Terrorblade, and Morphling. So you have potential to pick one and deny two if you're really scared of Illusion Harassment, but they need to think about this.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen the Kunkka Shadow Demon into Terrorblade combination a ton, especially in the Chinese scene. I think it's atrociously good for early push, but we'll see if Vega Squadron are going to be able to put up a stop to that. They go for the Rubick, which, you know, along with having some great spell steal stuff to take, he's also just really nice for lane control. His telekinesis is a great setup, able to make space for everyone to rotate in if the mid wants to come safe lane, if the safe lane wants to go mid. Really, really smart pick, I think.
Yeah, it's kind of peculiar, though. Rubick, one of the heroes that's not really that highly valued in the meta right now. There are a couple of the key players that run it a lot, but I think very unlikely to be banned out in this second phase by Kaipe. Pretty good spells to steal from Shadow Demon and Kunkka. An annoying hero to play against, and it does synergize well with Mirana. I'm just a little surprised to see it this early. It could also be because Vega doesn't want to reveal their cores. They needed to pick a support nice and early on. It's a comfort pick, so they just go with the Rubick, even though it might not have been banned. I'm curious what this means for the rest of their draft, though, if they have something in mind they want to combo up here. They do ban out the Meepo, though. Smart play, Vega. Not going to get Meepo'd two games in a row.
Yeah, I mean, Meepo's such a quirky ban. Like, you always feel kind of, like, really bad about yourself when you have to ban it out. But, I mean, Vega, they've got to be in a dark place after that game, so just making sure it's not an option anymore. Kaipe, they've got to go back to more, I'll say, traditional strats, but they can really pull out anything here for their third and fourth picks.
Yeah, no doubt. This is the beginning of a pretty solid draft. This does mark a difference, though, here, Annie. The first time that we have seen Faceless Void make it through first pick, first ban, and he will be available coming into this picking phase. Morphling now, the fourth ban out from Vega. So if Kaipe want one of those Illusion Bad Daddies, Terrorblade is available,
man.
Here. I mean, they could safe lane Terrorblade, off lane Void. Not that bad.
Give me that Bone 7 Terrorblade. I am excited to see that. Although, you know, I would not be surprised to see Vega go ahead, pick up that void for themselves. And then we could see the repeat of Sexy Bambo just getting solo chronoed like 5 times in a row.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's very true. Now, Batrider picked up for Kaipi, though. Now that I'm thinking about it, I think this is more likely to be a Sing Sing Kunkka mid. One of the classic heroes that he used to play a lot, especially when the hero was way less relevant. Could still be a support, but I think there's a better chance than usual that it's a solo mid Kunkka. So, likely to be offlane Batrider here for 33. But we will see. I don't think Batrider versus Morana mid is very good for the Batrider. I don't think anybody would do that except like S4. So I probably cross that off the list of possibilities for Kaipi.
I mean, I don't think you can cross it off. I think it's not as likely as the offlane Bat, but it's still there. I don't think it's super.
It's a kind of an ass matchup because Morana can pretty much leap away from anything that you would do to resemble a kill without a rotation before level 6. Like, there are some mid heroes that Batrider can really pick on. Like, TA, for example, is somebody that he can really abuse. I don't know if Morana is one of them. And I think that low base damage would really cost his ability to last hit. But who knows? Vega thinking hard about this one. They're trying to decide what they want to do with this draft. They have a good setup, a good combo with the arrow, but maybe deciding if they want the Faceless Void.
Yeah, at this point, I think it's so strong, you kind of have to take it if it's left in the pool, but the fact that Kaipi haven't opted to prioritize it, I mean, they've definitely got their counters worked out. Well, we'll see. I mean, there is still heroes like the Darkseer, seconds. Beastmaster still available as well, so grabbing up an offlaner might not be the worst thing. There's potential for an offlane Morana, but no, we're going to see the Druid picked up.
Lone Druid. Yeah, very likely your offlaner here. There is a chance they could aggro tri-lane and put the Lone Druid either mid or safe. Rubick, a really good tri-lane hero. Fade Bolt doing AoE damage. Just having a disable, pretty good right clicks. Morana, not a bad tri-lane hero herself. So this does open Vega up for a couple of options, especially if they're thinking that Kaipi might get a little bit creative here. Occasionally you'll see like a safe lane Batrider with an aggro tri-in. Kunkka Shadow Demon, also heroes that can really shine in aggro tri-lane type scenarios because you have a guaranteed disable into follow-up Torrent. So this could be another interesting laning phase. Game 1 was pretty hard to predict, Annie, and Game 2 shaping up to be a little bit more of the same on that front. Both teams with a lot of versatility in their opening picks. That seems to be the name of the game in this meta.
Absolutely. I think nearly every hero is completely viable. We've seen a bunch of quirky picks so far. And, you know, 3 months ago, you showed us these lineups. We'd say, oh, these teams are just playing around, not taking this seriously. But there are just so many viable combinations right now. It's absurd.
Yeah, now Juggernaut for Kaipi. A good carry to follow up with the Batrider. Again, more flexibility. Probably Jug safe lane, but occasionally you'll see him move his way in towards the mid. Still not sure if it's a core support Kunkka as we move into our fifth picks, but Omni Slash does combo well with Lasso. Great follow-up, great burst damage.
Yep, he's one of those reliable cores that if you're ever in a peculiar place where you don't want a certain mechanic, he's just all around easy to farm up, accelerates very quickly, he can carry super hard, he can scale late game nicely, so just a reliable pick. And now Slardar, Vega, they've got themselves a bunch of lockdown now. I mean, they've got Rubick Telekinesis, yeah. Bare Roots, Crushes, Arrows. Are Kaipi slippery enough to get away with this?
This is a tough game for the Jug, I think. You've got Slardar bashes. You've got minus armor from Slardar just to make the Juggernaut a little more squishy when you're going blow for blow. Plus, you've got Lone Druid, Entangling Claws from the Bear, go through magic immunity, so Jug can't just spin TP home reliably if the Lone Druid is nearby. Just not an easy game for him in general. I kind of feel like this Vega draft has a lot of big bad bruisers, and as long as they don't get run over in the lanes or fall victim to kind of strange rotations, they've got heroes that are pretty damn scary in 5v5 skirmishes. A lot of burst damage, great mix of physical and magical, especially once a Radiance comes out on the Lone Druid, and Slardar with reliable AoE stuns to follow up, set up fights, counter-initiate. They've got a lot of ways to deal with Jug and Batrider, I think. So kind of curious what these final picks have in store, as they should make these lanes a little more predictable. Now Vengeful Spirit, the final ban from Kaipi.
I think just a general nice utility hero. I'm curious as to what Kaipi are going for on their last pick. You're hypothesizing that Sing mid Kunkka, but I'm really feeling Kunkka and Shadow Demon as a support duo, and they're still looking to pick up another core.
Time will tell. Vega wants the ban here. This is a tough one to call. What is the Kaipe draft missing? I think they need a little Stunned. Bit more burst damage. I mean, they have weird amount of control.
It's like big, long cooldown stuff. Like, yeah, you've got X into Torrent, but that's really situational whether you hit it. You've got Lasso, which can be prevented a couple of ways. Shadow Demon Disruption is so-so.
I mean, I would say they're missing Burst and late game, and Tinker is both of those. So really good ban from Vega. Whether or not they wanted to run this Kunkka as a core support, this is about as good of a fifth ban, I think, as you can come up with.
Show me Terrorblade and a mid jug, I will be a happy camper.
That could work. I think that would secure some good late game, a nice beefy hero. He's so strong against the Slardar amp damage, but Ancient Apparition again for Vega. Okay, I like it. I'm thinking they might egg. Are they going to aggro try? Rubick Ancient Apparition, very good aggro tri lane support.
Oh yeah, that could
with
definitely
a Slardar on top. You can get guaranteed cold feet procs with all that disable. Could be really nasty. Hypey, with that in mind, what's the final pick here, boys? This one tough to call.
Yeah, I mean, they could go in two different directions. If they want to pick up a secondary support and run the Kunkka as the mid jug safe lane, fine. If they want to throw jug mid, have Kunkka Shadow Demon as a roaming duo, Batrider off and pick up a core, can still do that. Kaipe, you've got a lot of flexibility. We'll see how they read this.
I think they grab a damage dealing support, like a, well, not Witch Doctor now that AA's been picked up, but somebody else that can do some damage, contribute to team fights, and boy am I wrong, it's a support Kunkka, and
That's
they will
gross.
Pick up the Lifestealer with their final pick.
That's really peculiar. Usually if you're going to see the Shadow Demon Kunkka combo, you go for one of those illusion cores. How are they going to utilize the Lifestealer?
Well, I mean, that is one of the things about Shadow Demon. He's great in that illusion abuse scenario, but that's not all that he can do. He's far from a one-trick pony, still a great support to set up fights, reset fights, and having the Demonic Purge can be a very valuable tool. It's a hero like Slardar, for example, who can usually just run away from engagements. You might be able to get the Purge and find a kill, stuff like that. They do have the Batrider, and that combos very nicely with the Lifestealer. I feel like more commonly teams would be picking Lifestealer when you have a couple of carriers, so it's not quite as obvious where the Lifestealer is going to be. You know, if you have two Blink Dagger heroes, for example, Lifestealer could be in either one. But now, if you see that Batrider cruising in a very forward, aggressive position, 9 times out of 10, there's going to be a Lifestealer inside with an Infest Bomb ready to go, and you're just going to want to run away. So I think that part of it for Kaipe might be a little harder to execute with, because it just seems pretty straightforward what they want to do with this draft at this point. But I will say, it gives them some pretty darn good late game. Lone Druid, Slardar, Mirana can scale decently well, but Lifestealer Jug with a Kunkka on top, that rum can make all the difference in the world in these fights. So to me, this one just really comes down to execution. Both drafts a little bit wonky for sure.
Yeah, I'm nervous about Kaipe's teamfight sustain. I mean, you've got the Juggernaut that can keep chopping away, but you kind of go in, do your damage and Blade Fury out of there, and you pick up Lifestealer to be sustainable, to go and keep smacking away, and you regen your health as you go. But if there's a well-placed Ice Blast by Vega, you really shut that down, and Kaipe just have to scramble.
Yeah, it can kind of go both ways. Again, all about that execution and initiation. If they have Slardar catch heroes pretty frequently, they connect with Ice Blast, can be a really effective tool against even Lifestealer. God bless, have fun. Shout out to CCNC, big baby. There we go. FNG, what a player. can be a very effective tool against Lifestealer. Even with the Rage, he can kind of make himself immune to it, but it's still a way to lock him down, or to secure those kills on occasion. You're right. The AA can play a big role this game, but also a hero that can get run down. And if he falls behind, has no levels, no farm, you know, this is a lineup on Kaipe that they could just kind of dominate the lanes and start to take over the game. With this support duo, high risk, high reward, boom or bust. If they rotate around and they find the kills, it can be great. They get a lot of experience while shutting down the opposition. However, if they spend a lot of time roaming around and don't find the kills, these are two supports that don't farm particularly well or fast, don't provide a lot of utility if they're massively underleveled and can become big liabilities. So they have to make these ganks work with this kind of a supporting cast. And you can see Bambo's positioning already. He knows this, and he's ready to put on pressure for a potential courier snipe, but getting some auto attacks in on FNG is not too bad.
All right, so these peculiar lanes have worked out such that Mirana Iceberg is going to be mid lane for the Radiant, and Sing Sing Juggernaut going to be going in for the Dire. Now, there isn't going to be that super, super aggressive tri lane you talked about, but we kind of got some
weird duels going
on.
Look at the bear. They've already got 5 stacks of Shadow Poison on it. Huge damage. This is level one. Mag already having trouble in his own safe lane. Meanwhile, back in the mid, Sexy Bambo unrelenting against FNG, sidesteps the arrow, but pulling Mirana out of the lane. Sexy Bambo just playing distraction mode so far in this match. And he's doing a good job. He's kind of distracting a hero and a half.
Yep, up top, Slardar taking a ton of napalm stacks, already up to 5, so we really can't lane this. Yeah, you've got the support of your Rubick nearby, but look how fast that Slardar
this
is just
is
melting.
This is a potential kill right here. Slardar is in a lot of trouble. He is going to take so much damage. Batrider will start taking damage
stacks
from the tower, but this kind of stacks, the auto attacks from the Batrider hurts so much. He needs to get one more stack up. That's 9. Can he get the auto attacks? Stun from the Slardar. Bambo finding a first blood elsewhere, and the Batrider can't do it. Great rotation from the Rubick. Slardar stays alive with 10 stacks of Stickular.
Look at him.
Turn rate.
He's just a tarball at that point. But
so
HVAP elsewhere
version did die. Yeah. Okay. All right, so it works out around the map. First blood does go to Kaipi, though, so advantage for Bambo.
Yep, and now in the mid lane, Iceberg could be in some serious trouble. You got the double rotation back in, leap up to the high ground. Can Pilot Eye catch this? He's got his disruption at the ready going in, trying to get some more mana, preemptive clarity from him, but nope.
This is still nice. They push the Mirana out of the lane, they deny the rune, be able to pick it up themselves and give it to the Shadow Demon, it looks like. Even though they're not finding the kills, this pressure that the Kunkka is putting on, well, he did just find one, but this pressure he's putting on is still very effective, even without bodies hitting the floor.
Yep. Down bottom, I mean, Bone7 having a little bit of a tougher time, but he's still easily able to control up this bear, and Lone Druid not getting a ton out of the lane, forcing the AA back, and now
considering Bone7
to
is trading evenly with the bear currently in a 1v2 scenario, I'd say that's pretty darn good for Bone7 as a quote-unquote offlane lifestealer. These supports are already smoked up here, Annie.
I mean, they're scooting around. They want to get the action pumping. If they go down and they get that bear, if they get Mag, I think that's going to be huge. I mean, what's your priority if you're supports and you've got your buffet of Radiant heroes in front of you?
I think it's more about positioning. Where a hero is likely to be and who are you likely to isolate. I mean, if Mag's farming the jungle at half HP, absolutely they'll go for him. But Ancient Apparition, probably the easiest target they can find. Very squishy early on. Low armor. Right clicks really do a lot at this early stage. Their smoke is thwarted, however. They have a ward down, but the Ancient Apparition was kind of hiding in fog. And that does break it. They drop a sentry, though, and will kill one of the Radiant Observers. Small victory there for the Dire.
Yep, meanwhile, mid lane, Iceberg could be in some trouble, still has the leap. There's going to be some pings as they do scout out Sexy Bambo crawling around, but once again, Iceberg first back, and it's really showing in terms of CS. You got your Mirana with 10, Juggernaut with 19.
Yeah, overall, I think Kaipi are doing pretty okay in this winning stage. It's relatively even so far. Even the offlane Slardar is on point with this currently offlane Lifestealer. So fairly even farm across the board. Last couple gank rotations not working out for the Shadow Demon Kunkka. Still forcing the efforts of Vega supports now towards the mid lane, effectively a tri-lane as they rotate through.
Yep, more and more farms. Sing Sing might be in some trouble there. He's only got his level 3 Blade Fury. Can't top it up just yet. God, look at the damage come out. There is going to be disruption coming back in. Pilot Eye trying to do what he can. Kunkka's Torrent could be slightly off the mark. Sing Sing, though, he's still up. Sexy Bambo jumps in, gets the X off onto Iceberg. There's no more leap available for this pretty kitty. And Iceberg will at least be forced back, if not killed off. There's that poison collect. And Pilot Eye secures a kill.
Yeah, beautifully done by Kaipi. Shadow Demon, worth his weight in gold right there. We're just talking about in the draft. He was able to keep the Juggernaut alive, set up the fight, and at the end of the day, secure that final kill with the level 2 Shadow Poison. 3-1 now, Kaipi getting a lot out of that, as Lone Druid still happily farming down bottom. Sing Sing now, the big benefactor, getting some free farm here in the mid lane. Oh my. Oh, that arrow can't quite connect. Infused Raindrop, man, what an item. It makes heroes like Juggernaut so much more viable in these heads-up matchups. Surviving kind of the burst damage from Mirana like that, but also just having the mana regen so important on an agility hero like this.
Yep, down bottom, continuing to farm up. I mean, what's Bone7's big goal here for the Lifestealer? What does he want to collect?
Oh,
what does he want to be able to do?
Up top, 33 gets set up on, and well, there's that trio of heroes we were talking about with potential for a tri-lane. Yeah, a lot of kill power still, and they'll be rewarded for that one. In terms of the Lifestealer, I'm kind of curious what Bone7 goes for here.
I mean, your standard build is just phase into armlet, into perhaps Deso, but what does that accomplish as opposed to another carry?
Infest bombs. That's kind of the only thing that Lifestealer brings to the table, and a built-in BKB, I suppose, can give you that guaranteed magic immunity without the need of a Black King bar. He could go into an early basher. You know, you can look at Assault Cross as a potential item. It sort of depends on if he wants to go for more early combative items or invest more heavily towards the late game. You can go Phase Armlet Echo Saber and really be a scary force for that little while, but it does come at the cost of going for some of the bigger items because you have so many relatively small ticket items filling up the inventory. So some of that depends on what sort of a timing type you want to hit. He's farming very well, though. I'm still surprised at how well he's able to maintain himself against the Lone Druid. Even just off, after all it took was that good start pushing the bear back, and now Bone7's been able to completely hold his own and like essentially free farming. Look at the CS chart. All of the cores farming reasonably well here, Annie. It's not too often you see this, where all of the offlaners are just sitting in lane farming on point with each other.
Oh, Sing Sing. He goes in, he just drops the Omni, blasts apart the Ancient Apparition like it's nothing. Now, he could be in a bit of trouble. Meanwhile, there is going to be the fight over here. They want this bear. They might be able to get it. They're turning back in. The crush from G means they are able to secure a return kill, and the Shadow Demon TP out from Bone7. Got no way to break this, but Kaipi, they went in. They wanted something. They got a kill, but they had to trade their demon.
Yep, nice. A chance Entangling Claws connect there, and he can't TP home, but the Life Sealer rolls the dice. Bone7 makes it out. He'll be just fine. 3-4, Vegas Squadron striking back with something fierce. Now the Lone Druid on top of that net worth chart. What's he got here? Hand of Midas for the bear. Looks like he'll just do the classic build, Midas into Radiance, and then take it from there with Assault Karas type items, maybe an Abyssal eventually, probably a Vlad's. Good, well-rounded team fight items. Yeah, Bone7 going in. A Slithering Crush, though. Not easy for Bone7 to find this kill.
Well, in terms of overall net worth, you've got your Lifestealer. He's definitely formidable at this point. He hasn't starved too much from being in the offlane like we talked about. But Batrider, still a little bit of ways to go before he's really able to start shining and going in with those Infest Bombs. That'll be a big turning point for Kaipi.
He's still farming very well, though. We're only 8 minutes in. Batrider, just about at 9k net worth. Tranquils with 1,500 gold. We're looking at a pre-10-minute Blink Dagger if this keeps up. And that's still plenty of time for Kaipi to kind of come online and start to shine a little bit. Kunkka, now level 5, so Sing Sing getting 3 points into this Tidebringer. So important on the support Kunkka, especially when you go for this build. You have to find time to give him room in lane so he can get those points and Tidebringer up and start doing damage. Eventually, Sexy Bambo will start to transition into a damage-dealing core on the four, especially once the armlet comes out.
All right, moving forward, they want to go into Bone7. There's 4 heroes in the vicinity, but this guy just crawling back. Looks like he is working towards his armlet. I'll get that quite shortly.
Now both teams' supports about on par with each other. An interesting gap, a level 3 and a level 5 on both sides. The hard 5 positions really playing the sacrificial role. Shadow Demon, though, I think he's better in this scenario. Really, disruption is what makes this hero potent right now with at least 1 point in Shadow Poison. You're not missing the Soul Catcher too much. His ultimate, not a huge difference maker. FNG, he needs level 6. And this might be a bottleneck for Vega in these early fights, not having that Ice Blast online. Especially by the time the Blink Dagger comes out, which is now only 200 gold away.
Yeah, I mean, you've got the Tome of Knowledge coming up pretty soon, so that can catch him up. But, I mean, level 3 is just really underdone.
You know, that'll get him partway there. Yeah. Sharing is caring as he shares some XP with Rubick in the jungle here. That secures level 6 on Spell Steal. So that is a difference maker for sure. And opens up some more potential there. Armlet on the way for Slardar G with the Helm of Iron Will. Still a little ways off. There's the Blink, though.
All right, moving in top. Looks like Kunkka picking up some goodies, just able to sit. And Sexy Bambo finally getting some solo soak on experience. He's got his level 6, he's got the ghost shift, but I mean, these big 5-on-5 engages are not going to be too common. I think we're going to see lots of ganks, lots of smokes, lots of pick-off attempts, but no huge run-ins until there's a Brosh contest, I guess.
Oh, no, these teams could definitely fight more. It's more about once items come online. Like, Batrider is definitely not going to fight till he gets a blink. Moonlight Shadow now looking for Juggernaut, but Sing Sing back just in the nick of time. He'll be all right. Oh, walks right into an arrow, though. Can they find this kill on Sing Sing? He's so deep under the tower, they're not going to be able to commit too much. Rubick wants it, though. Sing Sing gets off the spin. Oh, pardon me. Sing Sing gets off the spin, rather, and he steals it. That was confusing. My god, magic immunity on magic immunity. They get the kill on Sing Sing, though. Now Iceberg caught by the lasso. They'll find the kill there. G connecting with a stun. It won't be enough. Now Sexy Bambo grabs him with the X-Torrent. Right clicks from Bone 7 starting to stack up. They get the Ancient Apparition on the backside. And in the end, Kaipi make out big. Juggernaut survives way longer than he should have. And a 1-for-3 backfired gank. It's just so tempting. Morana hits a clutch arrow under the tower. They wanted to go for it, but it was just too deep that time.
A little bit of a misplay there from Slardar. He kind of knew he was going down after that torrent, after the crush. He had at least 3 or 4 seconds to buy out, and unfortunately he opted to buy his Gloves of Haste just after he died, so lost a lot of gold there.
Oh, yeah, that's really unfortunate. Yeah, for some reason, seeing Rubik in the Blade Fury really threw me for a loop.
Soon as the arrow hit, Rubik stole it up, so you knew he had it. There was the crush, and then he went in with his own Blade Fury, then the Jug Blade Fury, so there was just a lot of spinning.
Yeah, you don't see that one every day, but now the armlet's up on the Lifestealer, so Bone 7 benefiting from that little fight. Also the Lone Druid. I mean, Mag has just been passively farming this whole time, but with the Midas up, he's now up to 1700 towards the Radiance, looking at a pretty darn good Lone Druid Radiance Midas combo. 14, 15 minutes, something like that, and then he'll be able to start. A little lag spike there.
Hello?
Yep, still here. Looks like I just had a little hiccup, but we're back. Yeah, that was weird. Some squirrels chewing on the internet cable.
Get it together, man. We're professionals. Now, Sing Sing gonna get lifted up. Not much he can do about this. He can try to spin to victory, but nope. Seema with that stolen Blade Fury is still having fun.
Uh-oh. Now up top, a fight breaks out. They find Mag. Kunkka sets it up after the lasso from the Batrider. Iceberg chucks an arrow. Won't connect. Rubik with a steal. Now the boat flying across. Bone 7 will be brought down. Nicely done. FNG securing the kill. Gets the Ice Blast. Makes it a 1-for-2. And this time, Kaipi punished for their overcommitment. Good rotation from Vega to clean it up.
All right, so kill score going to be relatively even. Overall fight recap puts that, again, positives for both sides. They get the Druid, so Kaipi slowed down his farm, but they sacrifice a lot for it. In terms of our overall net worth, we are just tapping zero. It is very, very close.
And
who does that benefit?
Nobody, really. Both teams, it's just a dead heat. Both teams with the same general strategy for now. Farm in the lanes, look for pickoffs here and there. And honestly, everyone's rotations have been pretty on point. When the other team overextends, they've got supports inbound to try and make up for it. Juggernaut going for a Drum of Endurance after his phase boots here. So Sing Sing just getting a little bit of extra mana going on. Additional survivability and movement speed. The slower paced game overall, though, I think they scale pretty evenly as this game gets longer. Lone Druid and Slardar get scary, but so do Juggernaut Lifestealer. This game, to me, really does come down more to execution and rotations than anything else, Annie. And I think that first 5v5 team fight will be when we see the big shift in momentum, not just these little skirmishes.
Yep, mid lane. We do have Seema holding on to that smoke if they want to group up and start looking for something. And Fest Bomb on the side of Kaipi is hot and ready. You've got your Batrider with that Blink Dagger with the lasso. There's the smoke coming out from Vega, but unfortunately, they're not going to be able to find anything on Kaipi unless they want to go all the way back mid.
Unfortunate for Vega here. Smoke not going into the right area. Ancient Apparition now level 7, so he's got Ice Blast, as we saw in the last fight. Great news there. Shadow Demon now taking the cake, his lowest level in the game, 5.5. Still does not have the Demonic Purge, but they get a tier 1 tower down bottom, so Kaipi getting better of this trade thus far. We'll see if they rotate top and mount a defense, maybe just move into Roche while Vega commit to that tower up top. Yeah, they think about it, but back on. I'm not sure that they have the damage to do that one reliably.
Well, moving around, we've got a couple. Almost everyone's sitting on a TP, so they're able to hop back if they want to. The problem is they can't get there fast enough, and even if they go in, there's just so many resources to keep them locked down. So 1-for-1 tower trade. Now, the rest of Vega is going to go try to defend this mid. How quickly can the push come out? There is drums committed from Sing Sing. They're whacking away at this now. 3-3 sitting there. He's got the Blink Lasso at the ready. Who did they initiate on? They are going to go into the Juggernaut. Arrow flies through the boat. It's going to go in. It whiffs onto everyone as Sing Sing's magic immune. And now you've got 3-3 wanting to go. And you can tell he's just itching for the lasso. He goes and he grabs up the Slardar. Another stolen boat coming back in from the river. The Ice Blast connects onto a bunch, but it's not going to save the lives of Vega heroes. Two already back dead. They are sitting in the grave. Iceberg sitting around thinking, what does he do for this arrow? Just way off the mark. And now Batrider collecting those sticky napalm charges. Meanwhile, back in the mid, they get the lift onto Mag. The torrent connects. Bear doing what he can. Wow. But now Mag just scampering away from Bone 7, who's just willing to go full charge for this. Man fighting the bear, not the best options. The fight will end there. But overall, it's a 4-for-none trade in favor of Kaipi.
Holy Toledo. Good stuff for them. A lot of individual skirmishes. It started as a central 5v5, and then it broke into all of these little fights and chases, and of course, Kaipi had the better of it. A team that's very hard to run away from. You've got X Marks the Spot. You've got Shadow Demon with his Purge, as well as Disruption to slow people down. Open Wounds from the Lifestealer. You're just not getting away from this squad very easily, especially with all these phase boots up. And boy, are they punished hard. Huge income now for Kaipi. Our relatively even game jumps in favor of the Dire. About 5k net worth, 4k experience is their edge. And we should start to see that reflected in those inventories. Looks like a rotation from the Vega supports up top. They may try to punish Sexy Bambo.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot he can do. He's going to get lifted. He's just going to get drop kicked. Good God.
Good night.
No remorse.
All right, well, showing us what that support duo is made of, that's for sure. A lot of kill power between those two. And a cute little pickoff. Now down bottom, Sing Sing. He could be in a little bit of trouble here. He does have a TP. Slardar still lacking the Blink Dagger. A little bit tricky for him. He knows there's no Omni Slash up, but with the amp damage, could do a lot of damage. It's a bait. 33 comes on in, but a nice Slithering Crush. Stops him dead in his crash. An old bat.
Bone 7. He's crawling around. He wants to get this worked on the Moonlight Shadow. Very little detection from Kaipi. They realize heroes are going invis. They just scoot out of there. Maybe looking for rotation in the mid lane. Pylight Eye could set something up onto Lone Druid. Just casually spraying up poison to make sure someone takes some damage. Meanwhile, YOLO Boat connecting onto Seema. What tools does he have to get out of this? He goes for the telekinesis, but now being munched on by Bone 7.
Beautifully
2v1.
Easy
not favorable
peasy.
For
Grand rotation. The Kunkka set it up, made the call, and said, hey, get in here. We've got a kill. Meanwhile, in the Radiant Jungle, FNG taking a lot of damage. Ice Blast off the mark. Now Sing Sing trying to spin away. 33 looking for an opportunity to go in. Jumps onto FNG. The Nitrogen will be melted, and he will find yet another kill for the Dire. Two down on Vega. Now Sing Sing jumps in onto G. Omni Slash doesn't quite find the kill. Nice crush on two, but follow up Demonic Purge. G getting low, and a World of Hurt will pop to the likes of Pylai Dai. 3-0, 15-7. Kaipi are in control, Annie. Another convincing team fight.
Absolutely there. That is just dominance. Strut out. Kill score now doubled up in Kaipi's favor. It was almost dead even a few moments ago, but net worth, overall XP really starting to tell the tale. And how's that impacting items so far? We've got Juggernaut picking up as Yasha. You've got our Batrider already sitting on 1,000 gold on top of Blink and Force. It is a good day to be on Kaipi.
Yeah, and we were talking about Bone 7 items, and here he's gone for the early combative build that I talked about. Armlet into Echo Saber makes him so strong at this stage right now. He can 1v1 pretty much any hero on the side of Vega and have a lot of lockdown to chase. Looks like they could be in trouble, though. They've seen what's happened. G walks right into it. The boat flies overhead. They kill Slardar, and this could still be okay for Kaipi.
They're fine. What are you talking about? The bear goes down. Easy money. And on the back lines, they bring in the rest of the crew. Sing Sing, he's got no Omni, but he's got a Heart of Gold looking for something more. Seema, he's trying to steal what he can, but he's just going to get slapped up, completely controlled. Sing Sing brings down another, and they're looking for the kill onto FNG. He's surrounded by four. Not much he can get done, and he will drop once again. The lone survivor, the lone druid who wants nothing to do with these skirmishes.
Yeah, I mean, right now Mag is trying to do everything he can, saying, guys, please, just let me get my Radiance, then we can try to take a fight. And Vega are just throwing bodies at this. And without a Radiance up, Mag really doesn't have a choice. It's not like you can blame this lone druid for not joining the fights. What does he do? He tried and his bear just got destroyed immediately. The Radiance will at least give him a chance, help with the burn, the mist, that extra bit of damage. But at this point, I feel like it's just too little too late. The bear farming well is one thing, but the rest of his team now falling so far behind. Just look at the difference in supports on net worth. FNG is only at 2k, Shadow Demon at 3.6, Kunkka at 5k. He's on par with the Slardar in terms of farm. At this point, Sexy Bambo is a core. He's probably going to move into Armlet, Shadow Blade, something that does damage next. And this Kunkka is no slouch when it comes to right click.
Yep, moving around. We've got another smoke coming in. We'll see if FNG wants to start this off or if Iceberg wants to shoot arrow, hit arrow. I've got a ways to go before they connect with heroes. Kaipi playing very slippery. They're grouping up. They're very strategic with their movements.
Smoke. What do we find here? Maybe Bone 7.
I mean, he's the easiest, closest target to jump on, but even if you jump on him, his supports are right there, the tower's still up, everyone can still TP, and he can just rage out of it.
I think Vega just need to avoid fighting until they get some of these big core items up. The Aghanim Scepter, relatively close for Mirana, at least the end is in sight, 600 gold to go. And they're forcing the issue a bit too much. Again, this bear falls just so fast. Might get clipped by the torrent. They will keep it alive, but Kaipi constantly keeping it in check and asserting their dominance on that front.
Yeah, the entirety of Vagra Squadron just booking it out of there. No one wants to be the first to bump into to Kaipi. And now, well, they rotate into the pit, and it should be a nice easy Aegis. Vega show no signs of contest.
Yeah, I think this one will be a freebie for sure. They kill it rather fast also. Oh, there's the little kitty healing ward. Most important part about this Roshan for sure. The kitty up on the high ground waving. The foreman.
Okay. oh god, Radio Dota coming back in. The Roshan falling low. There is going to be an ice blast coming up from the AA. And it means that it's going to easily go in favor of the Dire Lifestealer. Actually grabs up the Aegis the Immortal here. So Bone 7, he's fighting fit. Do they go defend this top tower being pushed in by Vega? Well, we'll see. It looks like so far they're just walking their way towards the mid lane. They're ignoring the push coming out. Lone Druid able to munch away that top. So it looks like Vega continue the pressure. They might actually try to go for tier 3s here up on the Dire base, but instead they are going to rotate down through the jungle in towards mid. But there's a smoke from Kaipi waiting for them. We'll see who's going to be the first to walk into that. Let me know when you get back in, Sayori.
Yeah, we sure will. Oop, we're loaded in just in time. All right, looks like we didn't miss too much action, just Roshan falling. It was worth it, though. We got a close-up of the Mr. Cat icon, so there you go. Uh-oh, Iceberg. Maybe in a world of hurt. Beautiful flame break to knock him back. Now the follow-up from Bone 7. They'll kill the Mirana. G with limited places to go. He'll get pulled back right into the lasso. Ice Blast comes in, but kind of minimal damage. Nice defensive disruption from the Shadow Demon helps reset the fight. Mag on the run. Kaipi finally starting to take too much damage here. They lose two. One of them is the Aegis Carrier. Unstoppable streak on the Batrider going to the Rubick, but now they've got to deal with Bone 7. He's at full HP. Sing Sing with an Omni Slash. Vega get cleaned up again.
Once again, Lone Druid just saying, oh, all right, going back to base. Unfortunately, his bear might not be so lucky. Going to get dragged out. Misses the torrent a little bit late on that X call back, but Savage Roar can only keep you back for so long. 300 Fredo. Pennies go the way of Bone 7.
Oh, that's such a cute bear. The disparity is growing here, and the gap between the Lone Druid and the rest of his team is getting bigger and bigger with relatively few results. Nearly a 10k net worth lead, 10k experience is the favor for the Dire squad right now. Juggernaut with his Manta style inbound. What is Mag cooking up next? He's got 1700 gold. I think normally you'd want to grab a Vlad's, but I don't know if that's really going to be much of a game changer.
Yeah, it's tough. You're definitely in a position where there's a whole lot of things you need, but can't really get...
Is he bugged on your screen, too, where he just lost all his cosmetics?
Who?
The Lone Druid. He's just this frail, hairless old man, and it looks disgusting. I would like to zoom in on it, but I'm afraid my game will crash again, so we'll just look from afar, but he looks like a... an albino, hairless goblin.
You're
disgusting.
Having your own laughs on that. He looks fine for me.
Oh, don't worry. Twitch chat will erupt, but you're missing out.
Thoroughly excited for that. And yeah, I mean, everything's kind of sitting back, like you mentioned. Almost 10,000 net worth in favor of Kaipi. They've got a little wiggle room, but they do have to continue the push. Got to keep that pressure on. Got to keep Vega on their toes, because you let Lone Druid do his own thing for like 10 minutes, 15 minutes, then all of a sudden, your racks could be... down.
It's a fair point. I doubt Kaipi will rest on their laurels that long. I mean, they might not run into them and continue to take fights every couple minutes, but they'll keep this high octane for sure. Juggernaut is farming so well. Anytime that ultimate's up, Sing Sing is hungry for blood. He'll have a Diffusal Blade coming, I would imagine, with that Blade of Alacrity, and that'll allow him to secure easy peasy kills. Ghost Scepters will not keep these supports safe.
Yep. I mean, in terms of what Vega really need, spare the Lone Druid. We've talked him to death. Mirana has her Aghanim Scepter. She's doing all right there. She'd like
that
a blink. She'd like something. I mean, Slardari's got his blink armlet treads. You've got Rubick now with a four staff. AA, definitely a long way to go. If he wants to go for that Aghs, looks like maybe prioritizing a Yule's first. But, I mean, Vega slowly but surely keeping a foothold into the game. I wouldn't say by any means they're out. They've just got a lot of work ahead of them.
Yeah, High Ground Siege could be coming their way. I'll start abusing the Shadow Demon a little bit. There is a Manta Style on the Jug, so they can do this Illusion Harassment. Getting the extra stats make the Illusions do a bit more damage. It's annoying, even without a classic Illusion Abuse hero. It's still pretty effective. They'll get a free third HP on this tower or something before Vega can really react to it.
I mean, do Vega want to react to this? It seems like they're just kind of chilling out, waiting to go in for their own push.
Indecisive. Yeah, it looks like they want to try to pull back Kaipi with some aggression of their own. And of course, Kaipi just waiting to grab somebody with this Infest Bomb. Lone Druid pushes kind of fast, but they need to decide what they want to do, either rush to high ground or TP home. And in the end, Vega will find the better.
Sorry, the stream just cut up to Lone Druid looking absolutely ridiculous. Either way, we're going to see kind of Vega scared off a little bit. There is going to be an X coming back out. They've got this bear on lockdown. Looks like they're committing a boat for it. He's going to be scrambling himself away. But once again, someone might have to call PETA. He goes in with the Savage Roar and nope, Kaipi. Going to give this guy some mercy for now.
Yeah, okay. He's back for me. He's the proper bear, but there is like a little man inside of that bear's body that pops. It's like Men in Black, a little alien inside the guy's head. I didn't realize that was how Lone Druid worked. So G has his Blink Dagger now on Slardar. I do feel like the Slardar has had kind of a lower impact than you would have hoped this game. Had a kind of a slower start. He went for Armlet first. Now that he's got the Blink, a lot of pressure on him to come in and reset these fights. They're relying a lot on that Slithering Crush as their primary form of control. Besides that, it's really just follow-up. Like, you've got Telekinesis on Rubick. Okay, that's great, but single target, reasonably long cooldown, Fishing Arrow for Mirana, but Slardar's the one that's kind of initiating, holding these fights together for Vega, and it's been hard for him so far.
Alright, I mean, Lone Druid now easily able to chop apart this tower. He's got his Radiance, he's got his Hyperstone. I mean, this might be the comeback Vega needs. What is their primary objective? Do they try to take Kaipi head-on, or do they try to rat?
No, their objective right now is just extend the game, find farm. If they can farm evenly with Kaipi, that is a win. And they can probably farm a little bit more quickly because they have the Lone Druid. He can just send the bear off, use the Radiance Burn, push out lanes. In a passive environment, Vega will slowly start to margin their way ahead, I think. Assuming map control is relatively even. But now BKB is up on the Batrider. Kaipi aren't going to give them enough time to really have this farm make a difference. They're looking for openings to find ganks at every opportunity. And they're also farming enemy ancients. Little things like this are helping offset that difference the Lone Druid provides.
All right, Dire Courier playing a dangerous game, just going Batrider swapping out items, but that Courier was just sitting near the Ancient Pit for that entire duration of Sing Sing's farm. Could have gotten picked off, but Radiant otherwise occupied in this bottom lane.
Yeah, they sure are. Just dodging ganks, farming away Lone Druid with a chainmail. Maybe thinking about the Assault Karas up next, has the Hyperstone, so skipping the Vlads for now and just going right into minus armor. It could eventually be the difference maker when it comes down to split push. We'll allow him to siege faster, but now Batrider, Invisibility Rune, this could be the gank they've been waiting for.
Absolutely. Iceberg seems unaware of this. Oh, if they can go onto Mag, do they focus him or his bear at this point? I mean, both are equally valuable.
Oh, definitely. Well, that's really not the target he wants to go for. They can't really easily kill it, but probably the Druid, if you have an Infest Bomb inside. They do have a way to interrupt the TP home, so it's not really easy for the Druid to survive without friends nearby.
This Invis Rune running very, very low as they're working their way towards the Tier 2 tower, finally. Oh, the Sentry drop! What an amazing play there from FNG. Unfortunately, doesn't live to reap the rewards of it, as Iceberg thrown into the air, the boat to smash him down. Oh, that was a successful gank.
Ends up not being such a big play from FNG after all. He has the right idea, realizing that, hey, I think there's some trickery afoot outside of the base, but unfortunately it does cost him his life and that of one of his comrades. Now some pressure in the bottom tier 2 for Kaipi. They're going to stay the course. They take out the tier 3, and now they're going high ground here, Annie. Ancient Apparition dead for 15. There's the one glyph. Mirana forced to buy back. And Kaipi will back out and at least wait to reset and see how they want to take this fight. Without Lasso for 20, I doubt they're going to continue to pressure. Just happy to force a buyback for now.
Absolutely. And I mean, Kaipi, just, they know they're in control. They know they can starve out Vega. And if you keep that Lone Druid locked down, this is going to be a very quick end of game.
Yeah, and at this point, just killing that Mirana one more time will be pretty crippling. She'll be stuck in the grave for a long time, and now the mobility tool comes out on the Lifestealer. He's had the Deso, now he gets the Blink. It looks like he just sold it back. We'll see if he actually does commit to the Blink Dagger. But I do like it here, just give him some extra reach so he can jump on that back line and isolate these supports. And with the Desolator, something like Ancient Apparition will get like 3-shot.
Yeah, it's not going to be a fun time. You've got Juggernaut sitting on 3,500 gold. Now lift up onto an illusion. They go forward, seen with a Slayer. just absolutely destroyed. Now a torrent coming back in for the bear. Lone Druid has one resummon, but he's got to budget it accordingly. If his bear goes down, that's pretty much it. They can't do a whole lot with just the hero pool they've got.
Well, he does have a resummon, so I have to kill it twice. Bone 7 gets jumped on. He dies. Lifestealer down. Boat does connect on G, but this bear going ham on Sexy Bambo. They should be able to find this kill on the Slardar. Sing Sing comes in, gets stunned up. The Shadow Poison does a lot. Omni Slash bouncing around, finds the first kill. Oh. Now goes in onto FNG. Once again, Sing Sing with the damage. Bear might fall once. It's got a lot of stacks of sticky. A few right clicks, they'll bring it down. Easy money. Mag holding on to the resummon. There it is. 2 minutes. He has to keep this bear alive. Shadow Demon falls to the Marana. Now Sing Sing looking to make the great escape. I don't think this will be too easy for him.
Yeah, he's got his space boots. He's going TP. In for the TP. The root not going to proc wow. there. Bear not close enough All to right. go and munch on him.
How dare I underestimate the great Sing Sing. Well done there, but a good hold for Vega, all things considered. A 2k net worth swing, and they do hold their barracks, which is what's most important.
Yeah, so Vega showing some signs of life, able to take a little bit of a fight off of Kaipe, but that was mostly Kaipe just getting a little bit overconfident, staying here, trying to chew through a fortify, trying to chew through backdoor protection. Yeah. It wasn't exactly the smartest use of their resources.
They still found a lot of kills, too. At the end of the day, it's not a huge deal. They've got a big enough lead that they can afford to be a little hyper-aggressive like that. Somewhat worth the risk when you consider that the Marana's buyback is on cooldown. If they did manage to kill her there, if she steps too far forward, gets caught by the Omni Slash, then they're in really great shape to get at least one lane of barracks there. So I can understand the temptation at the very least, even if they did get overzealous.
All right, Iceberg could be in a little bit of trouble trying to blink away from this, but hello.
He's dead. Easy catch. That's the power of Kunkka. One of the reasons why he is actually a valued pick these days. This stage of the game, still very useful, can find easy pickoffs like that.
Absolutely. Now, Marana opted to pick up the Boots of Travel right before she went down. On top of her Blink Ags, I mean, it's not terrible, but is that really the item that she needs to turn this around?
It's an interesting choice. Maybe they're thinking, we're so far behind, we're only going to win this with split push. And if that's what they're thinking, then BOT is definitely worth for that. Vega with an interesting thought to try and go for Roche here. I mean, I like the idea, high risk, high reward, but they just can't kill it fast enough. They hand over a free tier 3 tower, and now Jug going in on the melee barracks down bottom. They have to get in position to defend. No glyph for the Radiant. This is scary. Illusions alone will start doing some good damage here.
Yeah, I mean, they're splitting their aggro. You can tell Vega aren't sure exactly who to jump. They know Sing Sing's got that magic community. They're going to wait this one out. Now Bamba goes in. He gets the Torrent off onto Mag. And the boat to follow up. The racks start falling. Mag stuck in place. He's going to be burning. They get the lasso off onto G. He's dragged forward. He's lifted up there. It's going to be an ice blast that connects up to a couple, but no, not enough damage. G looks like he's going to be the next to fall. Two dead. Marana back in just a couple of seconds. Buyback on the Slardar. Sexy Bambo getting slowed down. Cold Feet looks like they're not going to proc. He's far enough away. He's got his armlet toggled on if they can chase him. Well, they've got themselves a kill. Now Sing Sing on the run, goes in for the mat to turn Sing onto Iceberg. Oh, Marana is dead. She's got no buyback. This very well may be GG as G goes for the crush, is able to find a kill. They bring down the Lifestealer who does have buyback. Bambo getting low, relying on this armlet toggles, gets a nice little slap right there. Pylai Dino on his way back, goes for the ghost after the torrent to keep everyone back. He goes for the TP, and no one's going to be able to go and blast him down with magic damage. Blink
they
back
more.
In. Oh, wow. Oh, and they found it.
3-3 is not done yet. He goes in on FNG. Beautiful ice blast. Will find the kill there, but Bambo finishes him off. A very long sequence of events. And in the end, Kaipe do pretty darn well. The Slardar has to buy back. It's a 2-for-4. Including the Slardar's first death, he might find a recovery kill. Sexy Bambo gets brought down.
Gem.
A little greedy there as he hangs around. And yep, the gem will trade hands. That one hurts. And
that
makes
was
the Slardar's buyback a little more worth it. 1,000 gold traded.
Very overconfident from Kaipe. They just kept going in with these ultra low health heroes. And then miraculously it works out and they get the better of the exchange in the end. And then you just stick around a bit too much. So, well, gem now on the side of the Radiant, but in terms of overall net worth, it's still very heavily in Kaipe's favor.
Oh, yeah. A small misplay there from the gem carrier, but in the end, really doesn't matter too much. Their lead is so much such that they can afford to make plays like that. Juggernaut going to be happy as a clam inside the Roche pit. And I want to replay a quick moment here from what we just saw in that last fight. Just how long this fight is, as we remember, it actually started in the Radiant's base and then ended up being this great chase way outside. That ended up being the back and forth where Kaipia were able to disengage, then re-engage again. This commitment, they went in deep, but they were able to finish off the barracks. So even if they did get wiped up here, it's still a pretty good trade. This is where Vega get way too cocky and overcommit. Iceberg hops forward thinking Kaipi are just out. Instead, they turn, they pick off the Mirana, and then that's the green light to go ahead. Little misplay from the Lifestealer going in too deep onto the Slithering Crush, still available Slardar, but still, they make some big plays at the end. Good armlet toggling from Sing Sing, and now they're looking to go high ground back in the game.
Yeah, snap back to reality. Here comes Juggernaut Illusions coming up onto the racks. There will be a lift up. This team just wants to keep some control. He's spinning around, but it's not enough to even just stop the Manta Illusions. They're using their spells to control essentially creep tier damage, and now the real heroes are going to be coming up, and Seema already starting to take stacks. Will get X'd up. There's not a whole lot he can do. He goes for the Ghost Scepter. And now he's spinning back in, but look at Sing Sing just chop away at him. Oh god,
illusions,
can he finish this with
him.
The illusion? Yes! He gets the chop done. Oh no, the racks are starting to go down. Buyback from the Rubik, but looks like they're going to keep the pressure up. Sing Sing on this Juggernaut, he's just manning up. And well, X into Torrent finishes off the Slardar. He already committed his buyback. He doesn't have any more. The bear, he's doing what he can to control the creep push, but the racks are falling. Sing Sing, he's going to get the job done. You've got Kunkka still sitting back, going for more X Torrents. The bear, one of the last strokes of defense here up against Kaipi's onslaught of damage. Kaipi backing up. They're looking to go top. They've still got a tier two to work through, and they should be able to do so fairly quickly up against Backdoor.
Yep, and they'll finish off the Tier 2 tower, and Vega will hang on just a little bit longer, but still 45 seconds without Slardar. A pretty long time, given that Kaipi are still all grouped up, ready to end this one. Kunkka still trying to push people back. Glyph not available for quite some while. Vega going to have to make quite the hold here. Arrow flies in, off the mark, can't connect there. Iceberg.
Oh my god. Golly gee.
He's got an X from the... that was kind of cool. Gets X back by the Rubik, but FNG just gets destroyed right away. BKBs get popped. Vega relegated back past the tier 4s. Many of them survive, but their base won't be so lucky. Somehow backdoor protection is kicked in. I guess they pushed the creeps out long enough that it's actually keeping them alive. This might save the barracks.
They get the Root, the Savage Roar to follow up. Bone 7 and some serious doo-doo does not have an Aegis. He might be going
the
in.
Healing ward.
Yeah, armlet
so
toggles
much.
And the fact that he is a lifestealer means he is able to live through that. Now, Crush forward, they do get the disruption off. Well, he's going to be focused down now, picked up into the torrent. They are able to pick off the Shadow Demon, but that's not the kill they wanted. Crush, he's killed in the animation, and looks like they're going to have Mega Creeps fairly shortly. Seema, he's getting burned down slowly but surely, ends up taking some fire for himself, but yeah, he's killed.
Yeah, this one is soon to be over. Kaipi delivering the killing blow. Mag just staying alive as long as he can as the Moonlight Shadows pop. The bear kiting Bone 7 out of the base, but it is soon to fall as well. Mirana does find a kill on the Kunkka. Sing Sing just trying to get the hell out of this game as he focuses on Tier 4 towers. And that's it. GG's called. Vega will pass it over there. 2-0 Kaipi over the new Vega squadron lineup. Vega going down to the lower bracket, and KP now in pretty good shape. It's a pretty short bracket, so that means they move forward. Face off either